One thing I'm going to say, Governor Bush had 4 hurricanes in his first 44 days.
It's gone. That's not true. We don't have hurricanes in January.
Why would we not have shut down?
Governor, my name is Dr. Randall. I practice emergency medicine in this community for over 30 years. It's so sad to see so many young kids. Years ago it was cocaine and now it's heroin. That's the first question. Second question is, your view on the global terrorism really impacts the American citizens.
So on the drug issue, when I ran in 1998, I laid out a comprehensive strategy to deal with the drug epidemic, because if you look at, I spent a lot of time going to family courts. If you ever have a chance to do the kind of actually cure, you can get depressed where you may not want to go, but you see the unfolding of the struggles of family life when you go to juvenile court, family court, dependency court. And I did this a lot as a candidate to learn, to try to get into the understand what these programs meant that I was going to hopefully be governor to provide for, how you made them more effective for people, how you took care of the people that were at that point in time in their most vulnerable state. Because I think, my faith at least informs me that that's the proper role of government, is to take care of people that can't take care of themselves and provide the support necessary for them to get back on their feet. So this was the common denominator of most of the tragedies that you could see play out in these courts was drugs and alcohol. Domestic violence is almost, not completely, but it's tied to drug and alcohol abuse. The juvenile justice systems in our all across our country are tied to drug abuse and alcohol abuse. And the same for all of the varying places. And so this issue, what we did is we created a strategy. This is how it works. This is a great example of my mindset. Rather than say we're going to do something about it and then not do anything, we actually said, here's my plan. I got the legislature to fund the plan. The plan was not created by me. I gave them the blueprint. And then we created a conference of prevention activists, drug treatment providers, law enforcement officers. We had a full day where they validated the plan, made it more relevant, and then we went and executed on that plan, and we benchmarked it.
Started selling a business of it.
We actually, we benchmarked it, we measured where we were when we started and how we improved. And we put drug treatment facilities in prisons. We created 67 counties prevention coalitions to make sure that people saw the dangers of all this. And one of the great challenges we face is now what you're facing, in that OxyContin and other prescribed drugs became one of the bigger issues during my time as governor. And we created a database. I couldn't get it done to begin with. My successor, thanks to the legislature, created a database to track people, farm doctor shopping and pharmacy shopping, and these issues, and we made it less, less abused. But the simple fact is here in New Hampshire and in Florida and other places, people that are addicted to painkillers are resorting to heroin because it's cheaper. That is tragic. And so this is more a state issue than anything else, but this should be a high priority for New Hampshire. And there are federal programs and monies that you can draw now. That's what we did in Florida, and it was quite successful. As it relates to the fight of terror, this is a serious issue. This president has a hard time calling it for what it is. He can't say Islamic terrorism. It's strange, because it is. I mean, it's not a law enforcement operation. These folks, particularly ISIS, that now has a caliphate the size of Indiana, with hundreds of thousands of people that they ride roughshod over. And if you disagree with them, their form of Islam, you're either raped or you're murdered. If you're a Christian, you're going to be persecuted or beheaded. And if you're an American, you'll be beheaded without a doubt. They are barbarians who want to destroy Western civilization. If you start with that premise, and that's what I've concluded, then you don't do what we're doing now, which is incremental, reactive, policies that serve nothing. In fact, each day that ISIS stays as is, it is a motivator, a propaganda tool to give them more energy. Every day that they can stay intact, they're saying, we're winning. We're winning. The American devils are losing because, look, even America can't take us out. They gain prominence, they gain resources, they gain recruits. And so this should be, call it for what it is, and then develop a serious strategy to take it out, to take them out. That means a more active, less restrained military. We have 3,500 men and women in uniform in Iraq right now, but there's so many constraints on them that they really can't do much. The Canadians are embedded with the Iraqi army. The United States is prohibited from doing it. We don't have air controllers on the ground. So all these sorties that we're doing, some are successful, some are not. If we were really serious about this, we would forward lean. We would be on the ground with controllers so that our sorties were accurate and devastating. There are things that we could do to draw the rest of the Arab world into this. This should not be our fight alone. The first people that are at risk with